Hello， 大家好，欢迎来到丰臣秀吉，我是 Yoshi。 在上周五 Cathy Wood 跟 CoinDesk 的 Daniel 有一段 interview， 这段 interview 里面他们提到了有关加密货币最近在环境上面的议题，也聊到了是否各国的政府有可能在最后会开始禁止加密货币。最后呢， Cathy Wood 也提到了一个非常重要的观点，是从整个大体的经济上面来看到底 Bitcoin 或是 Ethereum 或是其他的加密货币在整个世界的经济体系上面会造成什么样的影响。那我们就来听一下这段 interview 吧。
Are we still in a bull market? Have we shifted into a bear market? Is there some weird dead cat bounce thing going on? Where are we in this market cycle? And is the cycle as we normally think about it even the right heuristic to use anymore?
Well, we just saw a 50% drop. So this idea of a super cycle that would never happen again, well, that's out the window. And I do think it was precipitated by the ESG movement and this notion, which was exacerbated by Elon Musk, that there are some real environmental problems here with Bitcoin, with the mining of Bitcoin. And so I think that a lot of institutional buying went on pause, shall I say? And I think there were a lot of expectations that there would be follow through. But we think half of the solution is understanding the problem. And I think that this auditing of that miners, certainly in North America, are willing to do around how much of their electricity usage is generated by renewables.Is going to bring that topic into stark relief and will encourage, we believe, an acceleration in the adoption of renewables beyond which otherwise would have taken the place. I was surprised to see this already in motion. A company called Talon Energy last Friday, merchant power producer,announced that it's raising 800 or would like to raise 800 million in the equity market, 300 million of which would go to just this ecosystem, including Bitcoin mining into its ecosystem so that it could encourage the proliferation of solar and wind faster than otherwise would be the case. We thought the argument was somewhat overblown,especially when you think about it, any progress is going to use more energy, right? Are we saying Bitcoin is progress, but it can't use more energy? And it happens to be already more renewable, especially in some of the biggest countries for mining, than I think most people appreciated. So the utility value here of Bitcoin and other cryptos is such that it is progress. We think it's, you know, the first global monetary system in the world, rules-based.
Absolutely. So let's talk, I guess, a little bit about some other aspects of the crypto industry. Obviously, you've been in Bitcoin for a long time. You've had evolving opinions on that and kind of or a long duration opinion on that. But you spent more time around DeFi and Ethereum. I remember even when we talked last, you were starting to spend more time there. It looks like you've been allocating to Grayscale's Ethereum fund. What is interesting to you about Ethereum and DeFi right now?
Well, we're so interested that we've hired an Ether miner. I mean, he's going to be part of our fintech analyst team. But we're intrigued by stable coins, DeFi, of course, NFTs. And we're also very interested that developers are migrating very, very quickly. I always say to our analysts, follow the developers. Let's see what they're doing.Because that's a very loud signal, and it has become inexorable here, you know. So we're excited about everything being built on top of the Ethereum network and the progress towards the new protocols. Ethereum is, you know, from a decentralized finance, a DeFi point of view, I've beenreally impressed at how it's proliferated and also impressed at how it survived the tests it's been through, especially the leveraging up. I mean, the coronavirus crisis was a good case in point. You know, it survived all of that. And I'm not operating within the DeFi space myself, but I'm talking to venture capitalists and others who do. And again, in this go around, they've been very impressed at how robustly all of the DeFi services are operating throughout this volatility. That's also very important, these test cases.
So I guess I want to shift over to the markets. I was triggered by the follow the developers thought. I want to talk about maybe tech more broadly outside of crypto too. But one last crypto specific question is, you know, so Ray Dalio announced a position earlier this week at the Consensus Conference, where he announced that he had some Bitcoin. He was very nondescript about it, but it's a big shift, right? It's a big shift for someone who's been a skeptic. His major concern continues to be this idea that if it gets too successful, governments will ban it, that it's its own worst enemy in some ways. What's your take on that fear, that concern? Are these private currencies doomed to inevitable fight from state level actors if they become too big, too successful?
Well, I guess I'd answer that the same way I have answered a question at the time about the internet, which was in the 90s, because this sort of conversation was floating around. There was a lot of suspicion. And I think the right answer there, and I think most countries know this, is that they did not want to prevent that kind of innovation from taking root. They didn't want to miss the next big thing. And the US didn't and led that charge. I think many other countries have gotten wise, and they're all trying to say, let's have a better regulatory footprint here so that we attract more innovation. And I think that is going to happen with, or already is happening with cryptocurrencies. The US has been, you know, very confusing from a regulatory point of view. There's no throat to choke. So I think a lot of people say, whoa, look what happened with Libra, now Diem. Well, there was a throat to choke there. It was Facebook. In this case, there is no throat to choke. And if leaders understand, regulators understand, look, the internet was conceived without commerce in mind, without DeFi in mind. And this is just satisfying a big missing piece out there in the internet that should have evolved way back then. I think they will be a little more friendly over time. I think everyone's trying. I know India is not being has not been friendly, but even India, it banned it, and then it allowed it, and then it bans it. So there's a little bit of a schizophrenic, do we want to miss the next big thing? Is this going to cut us out from the rest of the world and progress in some way that we don't understand yet? So I'd answer it that way. I think it's already on its way, and it'll be impossible to shut it down, I believe.
You know, what's your take on where the macro environment is now? What are markets thinking about? Is it all about that gridlock? Is it just about whether we're going to have a taper on interest rates? Is there a larger kind of conversation shift happening?
Yes, I think the shift is inflation. And we had been expecting this base effect and supply chain issue or set of issues for quite some time. And I think we're not worried about inflation as time goes on here. We are thinking the much higher probability is deflation. I know most people think that's crazy given what's going on, but we have seen a crack in some commodity prices already, lumber, an important one. What we think has happened here is consumers have spent the last year spending their money on the only things they could, and those are goods, durables and non-durable goods, right? And businesses were behind the curve even before the coronavirus because of an inverted yield curve. They were afraid of a recession. That's what all the economists were saying. And there was also the U.S.-China trade conflict and all the saber rattling around that. So they were fearful and positioned conservatively. They shut down at the beginning of the coronavirus. The consumer took off because buying goods, and now, being vaccinated, they're going to shift their market basket from goods to services, goods are only 1/3 of market basket. Services are 2/3. So I think what's going to happen here is businesses, which may be double and triple and quadruple ordering right now to try and get supplies, they're going to get those supplies as the market basket is shifting towards services. And I think commodity prices are going to have a significant fall into next year. But the other one is the good deflation coming from innovation. So we're seeing, just to give you a provocative statistic, artificial intelligence training costs are dropping at 68% per year, a rate of 68% a year. Now, artificial intelligence is going to be permeating every industry and every company, we believe, around the world, any company of any size. And then there's a third source of deflation. So you've got the cyclical commodity, you've got the innovation deflation, related deflation, and you have what we call bad deflation. Many companies post the tech and telecom bust and the 08-09 meltdown became short-term focused, and shareholders even more so. And so the shareholders said, we want our profits and we want them now. And so what did that mean? Leveraging up to buy back their shares to increase earnings per share and to pay dividends. And so what did they not do? They did not spend enough on innovation. And their products are going to end services will end up being obsolete, and they'll have to service all that debt by cutting prices to move goods.
Does Bitcoin still have a place in the world of deflation that you articulate, given how much of its narrative has been inflation?
Well, and it's an excellent question. Many people are saying, well, if you don't believe inflation's a problem, then, well, I don't believe it's a problem in the developed world embracing innovation like this, the more mature world. I think, though, in emerging markets, if commodity prices come down, a lot of them are linked to commodity prices. Their currencies will come under pressure. And I think what will happen as their currencies come under pressure, the velocity of their money will increase as more and more of their populations shift into Bitcoin and other cryptocurrencies and assets. And I wouldn't be surprised if the euro is among them, because there are still a lot of tensions in euro, not just in the eurozone, not just north and south, but now east and west with Eastern Europe. So I think the mother of all surprises in terms of currencies could become the euro out there.
那希望大家透过刚刚这个 interview 能对整个加密货币市场跟整个未来经济体系的一个发展能有更不一样的一个见解哦。那我们就先聊到这咯。如果喜欢我 content 的朋友呢，麻烦帮我按赞、订阅、分享、开启你的小铃铛。那如果对我的 content 有任何 comment 的朋友的话呢，也麻烦帮我在下面留言哦。拜拜。